Great. So welcome everyone to our next lecture on machine learning. We are still talking about Gaussian processes. And today we continue maybe even on Wednesday, but let's see how far we get today. So maybe we are also cover the full topic for today. So where are we? We've seen regression. We've done Gaussian process regression. I showed you how to implement the stuff, and I maybe showed you three different variants how to understand GPs. So how to view them basically as some generalizations of Gaussian distributions. So today we will look at the hyperparameters of kernel functions, in particular what their meaning is, and also how we can combine different kernel functions to get new ones, and then how to use model selection to automatically tweak the hyperparameters. And then ideally we also continue with Gaussian process classification today. So let's see how far we get. So kernel design, first of all. So let's look at a couple of covariance functions. So this is table 4.1, and I think here I'm missing, so I need to refer here to the book. So this is from Rasmussen and Williams' book. And they have a very nice chapter on all these kernel functions. So everything you ever wanted to know about these kernel functions are written out there. For example, they're doing the eigenfunction decompositions of these guys here, right? You remember that these covariance functions are basically the kernel functions that we know from support vector machines. And maybe you remember that the kernel functions are the ones that are semi-definite or positive semi-definite. And for those, there's also a theorem that you can have like an eigenfunction decomposition. And in this book, they go through many of the calculations where they show you then what are the eigenfunctions of these things. So when you are interested in the mathematical details of this stuff. The common one that we typically looked at is the squared exponential, also called Gaussian kernel. And so here are two check marks in this table. So what do they mean? So the S stands for stationarity, and the ND stands for non-degenerate. So what does that mean? Stationary basically means it doesn't matter where you apply the kernel along your x-axis or on the axis of location, the kernel always has the same shape. So it always has this Gaussian shape. Basically, if you have a data point at a certain location, the corresponding kernel to that one has a Gaussian shape. At another location, it will have exactly the same shape. And the same holds true for some other kernels, like the Matern kernel, the exponential, gamma exponential, and so on, rational quadratic. And those are all calculated typically by using this R, where the R here are basically the squared or the distances between A and B. So the kernel function here is the kernel of A and B. So let me put this on the board so that you get understand the table. So usually we write it like that, and then for example we could take the exponential of minus A minus B. Yeah, or if we want to write it for vectors, we might even write it like this. So those are the square distances divided by 2 times some parameter, and sometimes also in the front we have some parameter. Okay, so now this is sometimes also written as sigma square x, and then we just have the distances here, the r, yeah, and in this case it's r square divided by 2 times h. Or, as in the table, they write L squared. So, on the next slide, we will see why this L is called L. So, the short answer is L is for length scale. So, basically, the L is kind of choosing the length scale on the x-axis, right? So, if you go from meters to centimeters on your x-axis, then that would include putting here like a factor of 10 or something, or 10 to the minus 1 in here, then squared, since the distances are also square. So this is the length scale. And this is the overall variance. So that's also one that is typically omitted when we talk about a support vector machine, right? We don't have that here. But in GP, it's kind of relevant. We put it in here because we are interested in the variances of the output. So why for a support vector machine we don't care so much about these things? Because like the solution for the support vector machine basically has this form. We have the data points xi, and we combine it with some coefficient alpha i1 to n, and that will be our f of x. Okay, it can be typically written like this. And here now, well, this is x sub i. So if there's a constant factor in front of the kernel function, so it doesn't matter very much, it's just a rescaling of the alphas. Okay, so it doesn't really change the model class. However, this kernel function is really calculating the variance of something. So if I have an F sampled from a GP with some mean function and some kernel function, that would mean that the variance of a particular data point, so let's take a single data point x, plug it into the function, and now the random piece here is the f coming from a GP, and this will be sigma squared times this, it will be exactly k of x comma x, and in this case, if I have a sigma square in front of this, there will be a sigma square, and so on and so forth. So changing this number here doesn't change the solution for a support vector machine, but it changes the variance of a particular data point, as we will see in a second. I also show you the same thing again in code. However, all these, when I see an R in here, it basically stands for the squared distances here, or let's say just for the distances. In this case, we put the two as well. So those are the squared distances. Let's look at other kernels. So here's the exponential one, it also has e to the minus r, where the r are now also the distances between the two input vectors, yeah, but now divided only by l, because the l should have the same unit as the stuff on top. So if I have r squared, I need l squared. If I don't have that, I just have an l. So that's how you could make sense out of this formula. Similarly here, if I take it to the power of gamma, then basically the l is also going to the power of gamma, okay? And now all these stationary kernels are the ones with the R, because they only depend on the distance between two vectors. So it doesn't matter where on my x-axis I am. I will only calculate the distance. If this is A, I calculate the distance to some other point P, and only the distance is relevant to calculate the similarity. Okay, and that's basically another description for being stationary. Now, what about the other ones? How do they calculate their similarity? Their similarity here, for example, of the linear kernel is basically the inner product between two vectors. This one looks now a little bit complicated here, but the reason being that in this case now they put parameters in front of each of the coordinate of the linear kernel. So if you forget about the sigma here, then basically you have these x times x prime, okay? So you really take the inner product between two vectors. However, here they've wrote it more interestingly, so possibly you have different entries in your vector x with different units, and then maybe you want to have hyperparameters for the different scales of the different units. In principle, you could also put all these parameters in this expression for the polynomial kernel, right? So why not? So the polynomial kernel also does not depend on the distance between two points, but on something more complicated. Actually, now for scalars, like on the real line, if those are your locations, this is just multiplying two numbers. And so it shows kind of, so two points are similar when they are very close to each other in a way, but this number can get arbitrarily large if the numbers get very large. So this is kind of something weird is happening here for those in terms of stationarity. So depending on the location, I will have very different numbers. So it's not translation invariant, this kernel function. And that's why they don't have the checkbox over there. So what about this one? So that is just the constant kernel function. So it's a kernel function that always evaluates to sigma. So it doesn't look at A and B. So it's also stationary, right? So it's everywhere the same. By the way, the constant covariance function is another way to include the likelihood into the kernel, right? So we could include some constant plus sigma in here, right? As we've seen, and that corresponds to having noise on the observations. So we could either have it in here, or we say we write down a likelihood. So often the distinction is important, because like last time I showed you that there's a distinction between the function values and the measurements of the function values. So if you want to be very precise about that, you don't include the plus sigma squared into the kernel, but you keep it separate. And then for your observations, you have the kernel matrix plus sigma squared, and for your measurements, you don't have the plus sigma squared, okay? Yet another technical detail. So Then curiously, there's also a neural network down here. Okay, so that's kind of funny. So what does a neural network has to do down here? And for this, we should look at the book, what they really mean by this. But they put it in here. And what they did is they say, so now what if my feature function, oh, here's some space. So what is my feature function that I'm looking at is some neural network, okay, with some linear kernel and some nonlinearity. So then I can also calculate basically the inner product into this feature space here, yeah, by this calculation. And now the question is, what kernel function comes out of this one? For example, if I take a tangens hyperbolicus nonlinearity in my neural network. And as it turns out, the output, the kernel that you use won't be something like whatever, A transpose B plus a constant or something. So that might be something that you would guess to be the kernel function because there's tangens hyperbolicus in here or something. However, it's more complicated and it turns out to be this inverse of a sine function, okay? And don't worry too much about it. It's just a curious thing that also like a single layer of a neural network can be seen like an interesting feature transformation for which we can calculate the covariance function, okay? And curiously now by using this kernel function here, it's like using then GPs, but having basically similar parameters or similar parameterization like a neural network, okay? Which is kind of curious. Then there's another column here, the ND column, and the D stands for degenerate and non-degenerate, the ND. So now, what is the degenerate covariance function? So degenerate, something like there's something broken about it, okay? So it's degenerate, so it's broken. And basically what it says in the caption here is that the degenerate covariance functions have finite rank. Okay, interesting. As you might have seen in one of the exercises, or maybe also in the lecture, the linear kernel, if you use a linear kernel, basically you are multiplying the data points with each other directly using the inner products, and then the dimensionality of the resulting space is limited by the dimensionality that you start with. Okay, so suppose your input space is five-dimensional, yeah, when you then basically use the identity function for your as your feature extraction to get the linear kernel, yeah, then at the end your kernel space also is only five-dimensional. So it's limited by the number of dimensions that you start with. And that is a property that the other ones don't have. So for example, the squared exponential one can show that the resulting feature space is infinitely dimensional. So it's becoming more a non-parametric method where the dimensionality depends on the number of data points and not so much on the dimensionality of your input dimensions. Similarly, for the polynomial kernel, even though the the feature space is very, very high dimensional, right? There was this interesting expression, maybe that I mentioned during the lecture, or you did a calculation, maybe also on some of the exercise sheets, where you had to calculate for different parameters p here, what is the dimensionality of the feature space, and it's growing very quickly. However, it's a constant function of the dimensionality of x and the parameter p. So also this one is not infinitely dimensional. So in a way, this checkbox basically means that those really correspond then to non-parametric methods, which are really infinitely dimensionally modeled classes. So the statistician would say, okay, those are the really dangerous ones where you really have to be careful what you're doing because of infinitely many parameters in principle. And those are the easy ones. However, of course, we want to have expressibility here in machine learning, so we are very happy to have these. So that's the ND column over here. So now all these functions that are here are candidates that you can play around with. And they all typically have like a reason for existence. So someone came up with them at some point, maybe with the Matern kernel in regression because you want to do smoothing of functions which have like sharp edges. And where smoothing sounds like you make everything nice looking, but smoothing with such kernel functions could mean that you're averaging your data locally, but in a way that you also allow sharp edges, for example, okay, which is quite interesting stuff. Anyway, so those are examples. Let's again look at the squared exponential kernel and add its parameters. As I said, the sigma square at the beginning here, okay, that's basically a scaling the output. So it's a parameter that that can be adjusted to be adjusted to the scaling of the y-axis, right? So if you have a regression problem and you scale the output by a factor of 10, then it could happen that basically your use kernel that you use doesn't work anymore very well. And the reason being that it is working on the wrong output scale, okay? And so this parameter sigma needs to be tuned to your data. And just to stress that given a kernel function like that, if you multiply it with a positive constant, then the result will be also a kernel function that can be seen very simply by considering a kernel matrix K, which is by definition positive definite. So for any vector V, from multiplying from the left and from the right, you get a positive number. And if that's the case, and now I replace my kernel matrix with sigma square times the kernel matrix, right? So that's basically corresponds to sigma square times little k. Then I can just drag out the sigma square. And since this part is greater than zero, and sigma square is a positive number, the whole thing will be a positive number, okay? So this shows that if I have a kernel function, I can always put a positive constant in front of it. What about scaling the inputs? So that's something, in this case, that the h is doing, yeah? And this is changing the length scale. So maybe this parameter is better to write L square, because that kind of makes clear the correct unit that we want to have, that the L is then also better interpretable if I use this L, right? Then if my length scale, suppose I'm measuring like these ppm for the CO2 example from the Mauna Loa data, for example, then this is measured in parts per million, right? It has a certain unit. And then after doing model selection, my Bayesian method says, okay, the L is being equal to 100, then it's not only 100, but it's 100 ppm, okay? So the length, the relevant length scale is like 100 ppm, and it tells me something about confidence intervals that I then can really interpret afterwards. However, we can view it more generally. So in principle, we can put any monotonically increasing transformation phi, like instead of a and b, and we will get a positive semi-definite function, okay? Which is a little bit more involved to show. So let's again visually look what's happening if we change these parameters. And for this, let's have a look again at our code. So ideally, my code is running. So where is it that I want to show you? Role of hyperparameters. Okay, so let's start basically with this simple data set here. So this is a simple data set, these 3 points from the beginning. Okay, so I'm surprised that they look like this. And now I'm having a squared exponential kernel function. And here I'm having the hyperparameters of this kernel, okay? And let's start and put them all to 1.0, okay? Then you see that there is a certain length scale, but actually this is not the data I want to look at. So let me reload the data. So where's the data? I wanted to have the zero one. So that one I wanted to have, that's the one that we also looked at last time. So let's use that one and we run it. Okay, so that is the result if my parameters are 1.0, 1.0, 1.0. And now let's play around with the numbers a little bit to see the effect, what's happening to the output that we get here. And then after that, we will look at model selection, how to automatically tune the parameters. But before automatically tuning the parameters, let's try to get a feeling what they mean, okay? And as I said already, the output scaling is determining the variance on the y-axis. And as you can see here, this value is very large. It's like 13. So the variance of my GP doesn't allow me to get up here, okay? I can also view it by not only plotting the posterior, but by plotting the prior. And if I plot the prior, you see the mean function here is zero, and I have a certain variance. So it's assuming that, like, this is the 95 percentile here, so 95% confidence interval, so it's plus 2 times the standard deviation. So we're assuming that kind of hand-wavily 95% of my data should be in this tube here, okay? Which of course it isn't, right? My numbers are much larger. So I have a much larger variance on the y-axis. So I should increase this variance here. So let's do it by a factor of 10. So let's change that. And let's do the plots again. And now the plots for the priors now has changed that now it's going up to 20 here, okay, and down to minus 20. And that is now more reasonable where my data also is. And actually, as it turns out, now I'm finding a line that goes nicely through my data. As you can see, also the overall variance at all the other location has increased, right? Why has it increased also in that area? That's the case, so I'm saying I'm allowing really a large variance with a standard deviation of 10, yeah, to plus and minus here. And so if I have observations on the left and on the right, then I'm kind of constrained to be somewhere in between here. But with a very large variance, the larger I'm away from my two data points. Okay, so that can be seen here. Of course, I can further increase it. So let me first switch off the prior plot, because I think that's obvious what will happen. So what's happening if I put a 100 here? Yeah, what will happen is that now this looks like a straight line, but it's just because it's reducing the scale on the y, because it wants to accommodate here these super large variances that are outputted here. So it also shows you that when you do a GP regression, maybe that is a better parameter to use 10, then the variances that you get here are basically a function of the hyperparameters, of course, right? So if you put arbitrary hyperparameters here, somehow also the variances that you're estimating here, they're also arbitrarily large or small. Nonetheless, like qualitatively, they give you nice results, right? So where the data is, you have smaller ones, and where you don't have data, you get larger ones. And now suppose you want to do active learning, which is an interesting thing, where you say, okay, I'm having these three data points, where should I do my next measurement? Okay, so suppose you are drilling for oil somewhere, yeah? So in the pre-solar energy area, people were drilling for oil. I guess they are still doing it. Anyway, so you drilled over here, yeah? You get a certain measurement, you drilled over there and over there, you get a certain measurement. So what drilling will give you the most information? So probably somewhere approximately in here, in the middle, okay? And that then reduces the variance for understanding how the land below looks like. Actually, these methods called Gaussian processes in machine learning and in statistics, they are called kriging, yeah, with K-R-I-N-G-I-N-G, kriging. And that is the methods from geophysics that actually has been actively used for drilling for oil, for example. So these GP methods using this kind of mathematics is like a well-known method in the applied sciences. Okay, so far so good. So we see how the variance here influences, in a way, the possibility to really reach this point, right? But on the other hand, also increases the variances in the areas where we don't know what to fit. So in a way, here's a trade-off, right? On the one hand, we want to have a nice fit through our data, yeah? On the other hand, we want to keep the overall variances small. And as we will see in a second, those are exactly the two terms that we are optimizing in the model selection, okay? So next, what can we do with the input scaling? So the input scaling, let's increase it, for example, or now let's first decrease it. So let's say we have 0.1. And that means the characteristic land scale is now not 1.0, but it's 0.1. So what does it mean? It means who is similar to you. So if it's 1.0, then the interval who you considered similar to yourself, so similar locations, is much larger than if you put it to 0.1. So if I run this, yeah, what I get is now something, okay, here I know there's a point value, but then around it, only for a small interval, I'm trusting this number, okay? So only very close to this point, I'm trusting the 14 or the 13. But then when I'm getting further away, I'm not trusting it anymore. They are not similar anymore. And now why is it going to zero? Because that was your mean function. So your mean function is telling you the default. And then if you don't trust your data because you say, now this location is not at all similar to that one and it's not at all similar to the other one, then I'm better off by just choosing the mean function. That's why it's going down to zero. Of course, if you had already previous estimates and your mean function is already kind of sophisticated, then that will be your default, okay? So it's, in this case, it looks really funny. Similarly over here, right? So it doesn't tell you much if the length scale is very small. So let's change it back to the one that we had. So that kind of makes more sense, right? So this is like what we would expect. Now, what happens if we increase it further? So if we increase it further, then basically it says everyone should be very similar to each other. So in principle, the point in here is already fully determined by that point and by that point. And we are just drawing a straight line kind of through those two points. And we say, yeah, it must be somewhere in here, but the overall, the whole thing is super smooth. So by increasing the input scaling, it's like also overly smoothing the data now. Okay, and we are at the end up with a straight line. Okay. And that's also maybe too much, okay? So maybe there's a compromise to do it like this. Yeah, then we have kind of going through the data, or let's go back to this one. Let's for fun also look at the noise variance. Let's decrease this function here. And now let's decrease it a little bit further. So I want to have like an, it's going up here, yeah, but it's not perfectly going through the thing. So now, how far does it go up? So in a way it's going up because it has like, okay, the output scaling says I'm allowed to have a certain variance in my function. So I can really be a little bit wiggly, but there's a limit to it. And part of it, that this number is so large, can be also explained by the noise variance. Okay, so it's a trade-off now between explaining this large value with the noise variance and explaining it with the function. So suppose now I'm increasing the noise variance here. So actually, I think this is a noise STD. So what's happening now? If I increase it, you see, okay, I don't have to pay so much for making a super complicated function here. I can explain the value up here also with the noise, okay? So I'm not trusting it. On the other hand, if I decrease that one here, yeah, put it to zero, then it tries to perfectly go through the data, right? And it tries to explain all the data points perfectly here with the variance that is possible. Now, even if I decrease this one over here, put it to one, so it ideally goes perfectly through the whole thing, okay? So you see approximately how these values go. Now, the question is, what is the best setup, right? So what is the best one? So I would say now by eyeballing, I guess this is a bit like a bit too tight. So here, I think in here, it's kind of overly sure. So I expect actually to have here a larger variance over there, okay? So I guess this is like a reasonable fit. However, can we automatically find these parameters, right? So that would be good. But you see, there's often a trade-off. So I could either match this point by increasing the noise standard deviation, or I can increase it by having the output scaling. Now, the good thing is if I have more data points, so let's add a couple of more data points, yeah, then ideally it gets better. So let's not take 3 data points, but let's say 10 data points. Okay, so here are 10 data points now. Yeah, okay, so let's play around. Let's take a couple of more, maybe 17. That's a nice number. Okay, so this looks like a nice data set. So let's play again around with it. Or maybe I jump to it from here, roll off the hyperparameter. So let's again first start with 1.0, 1.0, 1.0. And let's look at it. Okay, that looks already quite reasonable, right? So it's going through here. By the way, why does it go, excuse me, why does it go so down again here? So for that one, I think I can put here an x range equal to x min, x max. And I think I did an x min minus 1, and here I'm doing an x min plus 1. So let's see, that should be the same plot. But now let's say, so what's happening, by the way, outside the data? Okay, so what's happening? Ah, okay, interesting, right? So it's going down again completely. And what about on the other side? It's also going down again to zero. So basically it's not extrapolating very much, right? So it's more like saying, yeah, I don't know outside. So the points are super, super dissimilar. Okay, But let's first look at this and see what we can do. So we can increase, let's keep this view. So this view is kind of interesting. But now let's again put the output scaling larger, okay? So now this allows us to better fit the data and going up and down in here. But maybe let's again first only look at the inner points where the action happens. Okay, so I'm kind of can go up and down and up and down. And now suppose we are increasing the variance here. Yeah, what's happening is that we will get an overall smoother function because this up and down in here can be also explained by the noise variance. On the other hand, if I'm putting it to zero, then I'm trying to go perfectly through the data. And that is really what's happening here. But you remember from these polynomials that you perfectly fit through the data, suddenly you go to infinity and all these things. Yeah, so then that is kind of the overfitting solution to the whole thing. And so there is probably also something numerically going on here, which is kind of ugly. That's why we get this super large number. So let's just decrease it. But also here you see the function gets very wiggly and very complicated. And again, here's probably some compromise where we have like a noise variance. Maybe we can even increase it a little bit further, something like that. Maybe that's like a reasonable fit through the data, right? Good, so far so good. So this should give you some intuition about these scaling numbers. And this intuition is important when you run the model selection and you get some numbers, then you should be able to interpret them ideally. Okay, let's go back to the slides. So those are the most relevant hyperparameters. Sometimes there are other hyperparameters. For example, you could imagine that the 2 is a hyperparameter, kind of, that appears on top and on the bottom. And then it's kind of changing the shape of your kernel function that you're considering, right? And the shape might be also relevant, a relevant hyperparameter. Okay, the other thing is now we can have even more, be more creative with kernels if we combine kernel functions, okay? And suppose we have already 2 kernel functions. One thing is, okay, we can scale them, yeah? And that's something that I told you already, that you can do it. We can also scale the input. That's something I also already told you. But we can also sum up 2 kernels, okay? And that is then corresponding to a logical OR. Okay, let me explain what I mean by that. So my new kernel function takes the pair A and B and calculates the similarity with respect to the first kernel function and with respect to the second one and sums up the results, okay? And the interpretation of that is, so the kernel function K1 will be 0 if there's no similarity and K2 is 0 if there's no similarity, but if one of them detects a similarity, then the summation will be positive. And so in that respect, it will detect similarities that are either due to K1 and or to K2, okay? And this is like having a logical OR between these 2 things, okay? Why is that a kernel function? That can be easily seen by seeing that if you take the sum of 2 kernel matrices, you can drag out the Vs and then the whole thing will be positive, okay? So now if you have 2 properties of your data where you say, okay, I want to, they should be either similar by that one or they should be similar by that one. Suppose you have a high dimensional, you have a high dimensional data space, maybe a questionnaire or something, and then you say, okay, I want to group people into different clusters. Either people who have similar income should be in the same cluster or people living in the same city should be in the similar cluster. Then you make a kernel function for the income, you make a kernel function for the city, and then you just sum the results up, okay? Then you have a logical OR. Of course, there's also a logical AND, and curiously, it's the multiplication of 2 kernels. And the weird notation here with this sign, basically in LaTeX is called MAPS2, yeah? So that is mapping the pair A and B onto the product of those things. So, and it corresponds to 2 kernel matrices, right, which are multiplied component-wise. So it's not a matrix-matrix multiplication, but I'm multiplying each entry. So in Python, it would be just K1 star K2, okay? And first of all, so to make sure that this is really a kernel function, one needs to make sure that this thing is positive definite. And this can be shown, but it's a quite non-trivial theorem due to Schur, and there are some, I think, even some 10-year-old proofs. There are, I think in the book there might be more information and in the lectures of Philip Hennig. So here's more information about this pointers towards the theorem. And now, what about the product? As I said, if one of the kernel functions is zero, then the product will be zero, right? So if one of the kernel functions says, no, they are not similar, then the whole thing says it's not similar. And this corresponds to a logical AND, okay? Only if both of them detect a similarity, only then we will have found something interesting. Okay, so that's yet another way to do it. And so that's a quote from the lectures of Philip Hennig. So these rules can encode prior knowledge into Gaussian models, okay? So now if you are the practitioner and you know something about CO2 data or something, then you can design a kernel function. Okay, and let's exemplarily, let's just look at it, and I approximately tell you kind of a story about this Mauna Liu thing here, but I think I won't be able really to do it as good as the people in the book are doing it. So that is the Mauna thing data set here. So let me just plot it. Okay, so that's how it looks like. It's data from 1965 to 2010 in this case. And the measurement is here made in ppm, so it's parts per million. And it's going up and down, as I said, through a yearly cycle, because like plants are, when they grow, they capture CO2 from the atmosphere. And then when the plants rot, they will release it again, okay? And in principle, it would be like going up and down and up and down. But looks like there's a global trend that it's really relevantly going from 320 to 390, okay? So really increasing by a third, okay? Which is quite a bit. And this is then typically claimed to be due to like human activities, like driving around with your car or wasting or using too much energy and burning too much fossil fuels, okay? And so it's an interesting data set to model. And this discussion now is from the book over here. Yeah, so there's a chapter on the Mauna Kea dataset where they explain the details. And I only can approximately explain to you this thing, but the story here is we take a combination of these different kernel functions here, okay? So we start with a squared exponential, and in the discussion they say this thing should capture like the overall trend, like the overall function that happens there. So, and it has hyperparameters, so it can have a certain length scale, it can have a certain variance. And then there's the periodic kernel over here. And this periodic kernel is tuned towards capturing the information that's going up and down. So basically this periodicity thing. So basically capturing the thing that every January is similar to every other January. Okay. And by that kind of it is able to average all the Januaries to learn something about the periodic stuff that's going on. However, it's multiplied with the squared exponential kernel with another one that has its own hyperparameters. And this squared exponential kernel can like also detect if there's something not so periodic anymore. Then basically this squared exponential kernel can switch it off. So it can like slowly change over time. So one would expect that the length scale of that one is larger than the other one here. That is kind of changing the periodicity as well, okay? So in a way this allows that we don't have to be strictly periodic through the whole time interval, but we are periodic, but we can also fade in and fade out into this periodicity. And then there's the rational quadratic kernel, and that's more like an analytical beast, so it's looking much more complicated than the other stuff when you look at the formulas. However, the easy way to think of it, it's a scale mixture. So basically it's like a squared exponential, but a combination of infinitely many squared exponentials where we have different length scales, okay? So this, the rational quadratic kernel can detect like very long range dependencies with a certain weight and also very close dependencies, okay? Close time range dependencies. And it can kind of capture all of this in a single kernel function, right? By giving different priors to the longer or the shorter ones. And then depending on the shape of the rational quadratic kernel, so that's the third parameter in here, yeah, it either has more longer range, larger weights over there, or smaller outside, and so on and so forth. Then there's another one, another squared exponential thing, and now this looks like bogus. There is already one, so why do we need a second one? And the idea is exactly this thing that we want to have a scale mixture. So the scale mixture thing is capturing the overall stuff, but then there's like the overall trend we want to capture with that one, ideally. And then there's little stuff that we want to capture with another one. And so we allow the first one, for example, to have a very long time scale, and the last one then can tune into a very small time scale, okay, by this kind of looking at different effects. So I tried to copy the hyperparameters from Rasmussen and Williams, and basically what they get out are those numbers. And now what do they mean? So basically, the squared exponential kernel, the outer one, the 66, so that is the standard deviation on the y-axis that is generated by the first squared exponential kernel, okay? So the variant that gets added from the first kernel, right? Remember, if I evaluate at a particular point x, it's like calling the kernel function on x, x, okay? And for this kernel function, then it tells me the variance at this point. And so this first parameter is measured in ppm, so it's 66 ppm, okay? I think I have it even written out down here. Let's see whether it's down here. No, it's not. So where did I write it out? Up here? Oh yeah, here I did it. So it's 66 ppm, and it tells us something about the variability that is explained now by this squared exponential kernel. And the length scale is 67 years, since the unit on the x-axis is years, okay? And so it tells us something about the range over which it's kind of smoothing the behavior. Then there's the next one, the periodic kernel, which is this one. It has a certain periodicity, which is hardwired in here, and then also some parameters, but I'm getting a harder and harder time to interpret these. I can interpret, though, the one that gets multiplied with the periodic one, and that's another squared exponential one, that has like a little variance, 2.4, so only this little going up and down is kind of explained by that one, and a certain decay time of 90 years, which basically means that this periodicity is over 90 years going down a little bit and getting less pronounced. Then there's this rational quadratic kernel, also explaining again a certain amount of variance, and it also has a certain length scale. And in this case, we also have a shape parameter, which is telling us something about the weight between long range and close range dependencies. And then finally, there's the other squared exponential kernel, and that has a very different variance and a very different length scales for explaining more stuff. Okay, if we define the data like that, and if we also use these parameters, now what we can do is we can, where is it? I want to just do the simple stuff. Let's run this code again, and let's see how the result will look like. And this is how the result looks like. Okay, interesting. So why is there no... where's the code? Okay, let's put some X range, which is larger. So I want to see a larger X range, which is X min, and then minus 10 years, for example, and X max, let's say plus 30 years. Okay, so let's see how it goes. Okay, this looks interesting. This looks a bit weird here, right? So this looks not so perfect yet. So I think there might be a problem with my parameters. And it's also, maybe there are not enough data points that I'm evaluating at. So maybe I should increase these ones. Okay, this looks now much better. And now let's zoom in. And we can see that we are kind of nicely fitting the data. So these different, the combination of the kernel is able kind of to capture the relevant information. The other thing that we can see, that kind of we also nicely capture the overall trend of increasing here, and so it's going further up. However, of course, the error bars are also increasing the further I go to the future. Now, what about this thing here? Why does it go down again? So for that, let's look further into the future, okay? So let's see what's going on into the future. So how will the CO2 be in the future? So is it still computing? And it's going down and down and down. So everything is fine then, right? So the CO2 is not a problem. It's going down again. However, of course, you should know already by now, typically we assume a zero mean, right? So the default answer is zero, So somehow we are dragged down here to the zero at the end. So you cannot really trust it, right? You see also how the variance is really going large. So in principle, it is of course also possible to stay up here, right, and to increase. However, you see the influence of the mean function is very strong for extrapolation. So if you want to know something about values very far away outside of your data set, you always have to be very careful. Possibly this could be modeled slightly differently by saying I have a linear trend, so I want to learn a linear function, right? And then I'm extrapolating further in the future. However, of course, then maybe some people who are say that there is no climate change, they might say, yeah, you plugged it already in, right? I mean, you told it already that there's like a slope and you just measured the slope. But however, I wanted to see how it's really going, whether it's some chances that the data might tell us something else. And so this kind of model is able to do some reasonably looking predictions over here, even though we didn't put in that it should stay going up. That's just from this data that the data is telling us that the whole thing will go further. So it will be very surprising that suddenly it goes down again, right? So that super surprising, even that we didn't put it in. So remember, we modeled this upward trend here with a Gaussian, with a squared exponential function, right? One which basically says, so we can learn something from our data, maybe for the next 20 years, right? But then kind of we know nothing, okay? Then we don't know what's happening. Okay, so this is a really nice example, which shows you two things. So one thing is you can be very creative with the kernel design, putting like a lot of knowledge where you think there are factors in here. For example, when the climate changes, maybe the vegetation changes, and that's why you might also expect that the periodic function kind of changes across time. So that's why they multiplied it with the squared exponential, and so on and so forth. So for all the different effects that you want to model, you can put it in. And now what about this overfitting stuff? I mean, that's now, since we are Bayesian here, we are doing a different way of fitting the hyperparameters, which I show you next, okay? So we're doing a Bayesian model selection. However, any questions so far? So there's a question in the chat. It seems that the mean of the points is not zero because all of them are larger than zero. I think that is referring still to the example with the 3 points. All of them were above the line. And for there, we will fit a function where the mean is above the line if my length scale is set properly. However, if my length scale is very small, then I always go back to the mean function. And the mean function quite often in GPs is set to zero, okay? If you didn't have any previous observations, that's like the standard thing to assume. Of course, that sounds like something like the dark side of the Bayesian GP inference here. The bright side is, wow, these error bars, they are really super fancy, right? They really make the nice stories like, oh yeah, I'm doing estimation and I also know where I don't know something and I can give you error bars. So that's super cool. However, the downside of the whole thing is, of course, that we put in a lot of information. We put in possibly hyperparameters, which we automatically can tune, but we still put in something like the mean function and all of those things. And they are necessary to get these nice error bars and these things. But of course, you must be careful how to interpret the results at the end. Some other methods, they also give you additional information and you always have to be critical. So where does the information come from? What are my assumptions, right? So here I think it's reasonable to say, okay, I have data until 2010 and probably the prognosis until 2020, 2025, I think it's pretty good. And so that probably really makes sense, this kind of prognosis. Of course, you could ask, okay, I could have gotten that one just by doing a straight line fit, right? So, and then I also would have known it. Nonetheless, the whole thing would also work on higher dimensional data. So it's just a cartoon example. Any other questions? If not, as always, you can also ask them on the Ilias thing. I look there and I think last time there was a positive comment, so I didn't tell you. But usually there are not many comments on the Ilias right now. So that's why I didn't mention them at the beginning of the lectures. Okay, so far so good. Now, how can we choose these automatically? Or now how can we do model selection? And we had already a longer lecture on model selection. And there also we had a section for model selection for regression. Let's just briefly repeat this stuff, okay? So basically there was a hierarchy of things that are happening here. So if we view it as a generative model, kind of nature is choosing some model, some hypothesis H, which is something like, okay, I now generate data from a GP with a squared exponential, and that will be the data that shows up in a measurement of some physicist, okay? Then once I've chosen using a GP with a squared exponential, for example, now I can choose the hyperparameters or the parameters of the kernel function, for example, and those are typically called the hyperprior. And then I might have a certain prior on my parameters, right? So we're like in linear regression. And now, after having specified all of this, I haven't seen any data yet. So let's write down a way to get data, and that's typically the likelihood, right? Typically now I'm conditioned on all the stuff that I put before, so it should be also a theta, and my observations then are measured as noisy measurements of the truth, okay? Now you might wonder, so why this hierarchy, why these words? The words are kind of arbitrary. The bigger picture is actually there's a single prior and then there's a likelihood. However, we typically sort the parameters into different groups, and that's why we have parameters, hyperparameters, hyperparameters, hyperhyperparameters, and so forth. So in principle, we only have some parameters, but we typically sort them. And the reason we sort them is because by specifying a model, we are kind of restricting ourselves to certain solutions and allow the parameters to vary to fit the data. But of course, instead of choosing a squared exponential kernel, I could have taken a Matern kernel or something, so I could have used another model there, and so I could also do inference on that one, which one I should choose over there. And that's why I get this whole hierarchy. Often they are also algorithmic, so I have an algorithm. Once I fix the theta and the h, I have an algorithm to calculate the w, okay? But I don't have an algorithm to calculate the theta, possibly, or something like this. Anyway, so that is the hierarchy. And so I'm also having these different levels of inference. So I'm having like the posterior of my lowest level parameters, okay, which could be the alphas in the support vector machine, or those might be, in a GP, we don't do it explicitly like that. So in GP, we try to integrate out the GP. So that's maybe not applicable here. But in linear regression, we would have a weight parameter here that we would estimate that's our posterior. And don't worry about the letters. Oh, you worry about them, go through them like in a nice hour. And if you find a mistake, tell me. But this is like the obvious thing. You condition on everything else that is higher in the hierarchy, okay? And then this is just base rule. And similarly, now integrating out the W, we are having the thing down here, so which is the evidence from the posterior. And this evidence is telling us, given the model assumption and the hyperparameters of my kernel, how likely is it to see my data? And that can be used to get a hyperposterior for the hyperparameters, okay? And then again, integrating out the hyperparameters, I get an expression, the evidence of my data, given my model assumption, but letting the parameters and the hyperparameters vary, okay? And that is kind of the hyper evidence. And that one I can now plug into another base rule, to get also a model posterior over here, and so on and so forth. At the end, I have a hierarchical model and I can calculate the overall evidence of seeing my observations given the locations in this case and assuming having sampled a model, a hyperprior, hyperparameters and parameters. Okay, so that is like the hierarchy of things. And of course, typically we are only down here, right? So we're only having like a Gaussian here, a Gaussian there, and the output will be a Gaussian. And once we get to the parameters, unfortunately our priors are not that nice anymore. We want to have a prior on the variance, for example. And to have a prior on the variance, maybe you want to use a gamma distribution or something else. And then all these base rule computations like get ugly and infeasible for the mere mortals among us. Let's write it out for the GPs, okay? So my prior here is that the F is the GP. In this case, now the F is replacing the W, right? So W is a finite dimensional vector, but let's say we can also write it down with functions, right? Why not? So we have a likelihood and we can infer the posterior, okay? So that is like the usual stuff where we assumed a certain mean function, a certain covariance function, where the parameters are fixed, so they are not variable, okay? Also, the noise variance here was not variable. It was assumed to be fixed. And then we can write it nicely down. On level 2 now, we say all these unknowns get collected into theta, where theta is now collecting all the hyperparameters, okay? So theta contains the kernel width, it contains the output scaling, and it contains also the noise variance, okay? And now we can have on the level 2, we can also start with the evidence from that one, which is basically multiplying the prior and the likelihood and integrating out the parameter, where the parameter here is the function f. And again, this thing, I can write it down here, right? I'm a computer scientist, but I don't know really what it really means. What is an integral over functions, right? I mean, there are mathematicians who know what it is. I don't. I'm just using it here more like a cartoon, like an illustration, that you get the concept. But the math behind such an integration over function is kind of hard. We don't care, because we know the result will be a Gaussian distribution. So probably there is a formalism to write this properly down. We only care for this, that we know at the end it's a Gaussian distribution. Okay, for that we are sure. How to write it down in between, we are not. So we are using the most suggestive notation here. Okay, great. So now what about this guy? That's basically the one where it looks very much like the Poisson predictive distribution, right? So, but we don't do a prediction here. We are plugging in our observations in this case. And then the whole thing is also called the marginal likelihood. Okay, and again, that is the name marginal typically means that we integrated out something, and that actually what we did. So we integrated out something, but not really from the likelihood, so this is the likelihood, but from the joint distribution, the joint of the observations y and our function f, right? If you multiply these two functions, you get p of y comma f given the rest. And from this joint distribution, we are integrating out the f. And this integrating out corresponds to this marginal. Okay, so this is the marginal likelihood. And now what we're doing, instead to infer a hyperposterior, right, which is super complicated, very easily, we only maximize the marginal likelihood. So at the beginning, you start with, yeah, now let's learn something new. Bayesian inference, super cool. We are starting with the prior and getting the posterior. We don't do this maximum likelihood stuff, so that's like not so great. So it has some problems with little data. However, for the hyperparameters, that's exactly what we're doing. And that's what many Bayesians are doing. So for the hyperparameter level, we're just doing maximum likelihood. So here we are Bayesian on level 1, and we are frequentist on level 2. Okay. So this marginal likelihood is something, right? So it tells us kind of how well the parameters fit the data, right? And we are Bayesian about the level 1. So we are partially Bayesian, part-time Bayesians, but not full-time Bayesians in this case. And this is also called in statistics type 2 maximum likelihood, okay? And what remains to do is that now we need to write out this p of y given x, so the marginal likelihood, we need to write it out for the GP. And that's on the next slide. So let's look at it. So this is our method for setting hyperparameters of GPs. So we look at the log marginal likelihood, okay? And we know it's a Gaussian distribution, yeah? So I didn't write it out here, but it's a Gaussian distribution. And when you take the logarithm, basically the e to the minus term turns into a minus term, which is that one. Then we have the normalization term, where we divide by the determinant of the variance, of the covariance matrix. And since we are taking logarithms, this becomes a minus log of the determinant of k plus sigma squared, right? And then there's also always this square root of 2 pi to the power of n, okay? And that is the term in the back. So this equal sign is really an equal sign. So that is the exact formula. And that is basically a log Gaussian, okay? And now this log Gaussian is a function of my hyperparameters, theta, okay? So in a way, it is a likelihood function. As I said, a likelihood function is a function that is viewed as a function of the stuff that is conditioned on, okay? And so this is the so-called marginal likelihood because we integrated out the parameters. Let's try to understand it a little bit better. So we want to maximize the probability. So we want to maximize the data that we've seen, yeah, in terms of the hyperparameters. So what does maximizing the first term really mean, okay? So there's a minus sign. So it's the same as minimizing the term without the sign. And minimizing this term here in sigma square and the parameters of the kernel matrix basically mean we want to minimize the term. That means we need to maximize kind of the matrix in here, right? Because we are taking the inverse. So if we have a very large matrix and we take the inverse, we get very small numbers typically. Okay, so we need to maximize everything in here. And now basically means, okay, increase the sigma square a lot. So that's great if we increase it a lot, because then our data looks very likely, right? Makes sense, right? As I said, if we increase the variance of our observations, then any observations become super likely, right? They are all becoming equally likely. The other option is to increase certain parameters in our kernel function. So for example, I could increase the output variance. Yeah, that's another way to make the first term super happy, right? So, and I can have a trade-off between those two. However, in principle, both of them will help. Or with other words, now what about the length scale? So the length scale should be chosen in such a way such that the points are super similar to each other, right? So that's kind of what increases the K the most, if everyone gets very similar to each other. So that's kind of increasing the length scale for a squared exponential kernel. Okay, so that's the story of the first term. As you know, maximization of these things is typically a trade-off between different terms. So let's look at the other term and let's hope for the best that that one is trying to decrease the whole stuff. And then kind of ideally there will be an equilibrium between the two. So the second term here is minus logarithm of the determinant. So it's like minimizing the logarithm of the determinant. That sounds already good. Since here we were maximizing kind of the k plus sigma square, here we are minimizing the determinant of this matrix. And now what is the determinant? The determinant is the volume spent by the matrix, okay? So what about that one? So the volume should be minimized. That means, for example, that the sigma square shouldn't be too large, right? Because if the sigma square gets larger and larger and larger, the volume is just increasing, okay? And I think here's an I missing, so I should put here in a matrix, identity matrix. Now, what about the K? For the K, it's even more complicated. So suppose all vectors are pointing into the same direction in the K, okay? So the matrix K, the column vectors, span some high-dimensional space. And as you might know, the determinant is calculating the volume of this parallelotope that is spanned by the column vectors. So if they are all pointing towards the same direction, okay, so let me draw a picture up here. So let's look at a two-dimensional space. If those are the two column vectors of your matrix, then basically the area in here, yeah, that will be the determinant. If the vectors are in a right angle, yeah, you can imagine that the area is maximized, right? And in the other extreme case, if they are almost pointing to the same direction, the area is minimized, okay? So what it tells us is, choose the hyperparameters in such a way such that the volume is, let's see, so we want to minimize the logarithm of the determinant. So basically we want to minimize the volume, okay? So in this case, that one is preferred to that one, okay? So there are now two forces in here in this term. And the last term, by the way, doesn't contain any parameters anymore. So that one is just constant. So this term kind of tries to decrease the parameters, the size of the parameters, and the first term is kind of increase them. And they have a very different functional look, right? So this is kind of looking at the data, at the observations, why. So in a way, this is like a likelihood type of thing, and this is like a regularization type of thing, okay? So here you try to fit everything as nice as possible with large numbers. And here you are paying for putting two large numbers. Okay, so it's using the similar intuition. Why the logarithm of the determinant and why this particular form? That's due to being a Gaussian distribution. That's where their terms come from. Okay, so they are really not just someone not just came up with them because they are nice to optimize, but they were really derived from Bayes' rule. Okay, good. And now this thing is giving us some reasonable estimate of our theta that fits the data very well. So we let the data speak and tweak the parameter to in order to maximize this number. And let me show you some code where I try to implement that. So here's the code. Or maybe I should jump to the top. So where's the top? Yeah. And let's go to the, let's pick first the data set. Let's again pick the simple one. And let's again pick the one with three data points. Okay, so let's start simple. So that is the one. And then let's do the find the hyperparameters code. And here I'm just LaTeX for you this the formula, okay? So that's basically the same stuff. So there are no surprises. And so let's look at the formula or the code for the log marginal likelihood. And so the log marginal likelihood gets the locations, gets the values, and gets the GP and a set of hyperparameters. Fine. Let's look at the implementation in a second. Once I have that, I can define a function f here, a function of the hyperparameters, which is minus log of all this stuff, okay? And that function then can be optimized with scipy optimize, okay? And then I get the hyperparameters and I can look at them, what I get out of it. And I can also possibly, ideally plot the output, plot how the whole thing looks like. So how is the log marginal likelihood implemented? So basically now I'm calculating here the mean vector, I'm calculating here the covariance matrix, and then I'm having have to extract the noise variance from my hyperparameters, which is always the last parameter by convention here. Again, I'm defining this matrix Z. And in this case now here, I'm calculating once and for all the inverse, and this thing is often called alpha. So let's also call it alpha here. And this is basically then y transpose times the inverse of my kernel matrix times the y, okay? Where from the y, I first need to subtract the mean, okay? So that is the coming from the formula of the this one over here, okay? And you see on my slides, I omitted the mean. So I should put it in there, but often it's assumed to be zero. So that's why I guess I omitted it because I copied the formula from some book, okay? But I should put it in. In principle, the mean is in here as well. Good, so far so good. What about this log dead? So the log dead of Z. So that's like a little bit a funny function to calculate because the Z is now a function of our hyperparameters, right? And depending on the hyperparameters, the Z might be super positive definite or maybe not super positive definite, so not so great positive definite. So there might be zeros on the diagonal. And as you know, the determinant of a matrix which has like zeros, an eigenvalue zero, it will be zero, right? It corresponds to having here a very short vector and then the whole volume will be zero. So there are some numerical challenges. So here are different ways to implement it. So the first way to implement it is Z1. Just take the determinant of sigma and take the logarithm of that. But there's a better way, which is numerically more stable. So when you look at the book from Rasmussen Williams, and when you look at GP papers, or when you look at GP implementations, as far as I know, they typically do it with this trick. So how is it calculating the thing? So it's first doing a Cholesky decomposition, which we've seen already. It's like taking the square root, and then we extract the diagonal of this Cholesky decomposition. And maybe you remember when you have a matrix that is upper triangular, then the determinant is just a product of all entries along the diagonal, okay? So if the bottom part is zero, then it will be just a product of the entries on the diagonal. And so we extract the diagonal, we take the logarithm of it, and we sum everything up. Okay, what we did here, we exchanged the summation and the logarithm. We could have first multiplied everything and then took the logarithm, but here if we first take the logarithms and then we sum everything up. And it looks like that's a more stable way to do. Then there's the 2 times. So where does the 2 times come from? So let's drag it in. So the 2 times in front of the logarithm, fine, the summation is linear, right? And then what happens if I drag it in here? If I drag the 2 into the logarithm, it's basically becoming an exponent. So it's becoming something to the power of 2. Okay, so that's great, because taking the Cholesky decomposition to the power of 2 gives me back the matrix. Okay, so the 2 here is there because I'm using the Cholesky decomposition, so the square root of that and not the z. Okay, and that it's really working is of course something you need to try. So let's run it. So here I'm comparing, this is a speed comparison. Okay, so speed comparison is fine too, but additionally, let's say I also want to do, okay, let's first do the speed comparison. So which is faster, the log dead or the other one? And there you see, okay, the log dead is numerically more stable, but it takes 40 milliseconds, microseconds, whereas the log dead thing takes only 60 microseconds. So that's really already a relevant difference for something that is called like thousands of times, right? It's a factor of 3. So it is a bit more expensive. However, it turns out if you don't use the log dead function, but the other one, then the optimization is really not working very well. Let's check also whether we get the same number, so whether our implementation of the log deck is correct. So for that, we evaluating it for a matrix and we see that it gets the same result. Okay, so that is one of the hurdles of implementing this kind of stuff. The math is nice, everything is great. Then you do this and then the whole thing numerically breaks. Okay, let's hope that this is now doing fine for our example. So let's run it. And it's converging quite quickly after a couple of iterations. Remember, we are still having our simple data set, and let's plot it. And this is supposed to be the solution, okay? So it's different from the one that we usually had. So that is the one that's giving us the biggest likelihood, okay? And we can, of course, also calculate it. So let's calculate this log likelihood here. So for that, we need to calculate this guy, the log marginal likelihood for the current hyperparameters. So let's do that. Oh, we did it already down here. Oh, let me type it in like this. So it's minus 9.3.3. So that is the one. And let's try the other one that we used to all the time. So we used the one prior GP, and then I think, can I plug it in like that? Let's see whether it works. 10.0, 1.0, 1.0. And it's a little bit worse, okay? So it has like minus 10, okay? So we see that, okay, the minus, the negative log likelihood I wanted to see. So let's, yeah, okay. And that's the one we are minimizing, fine. So the parameters that have been found are slightly better. Now, what can we do with the parameters? Again, we can also look at them and try to interpret them. In particular, we see this is like the 10.0 approximately, and that is the output scaling, yeah? Okay, so the standard deviation is 10. That one over here, it's the length scale that has been found on the x-axis. So the characteristic length scale is like 3 point something. To the left and to the right, okay? So it is already pretty sure what's going on here because it has approximately calculated this length scale. And then what else? This is the overall noise, okay? So it's fitting the data very well and there's not much requirement to explain something with the noise, okay? Good, so it prefers typically to put information into the kernels and to explain only the rest with the noise. Okay, we still have 10 minutes, so let's, for fun, let's again look at the 17 data points, and then let's try to see what the parameters are telling us for the 17 data points. So where is it? It's Z1, data set 0, and now let's take 17 data points. So that's this curve, And let's again fit it. And I would expect that there's maybe a little bit more noise, right? Otherwise, the function have to be really very wiggly. Okay, so let's jump to the model selection, finding the hyperparameters down here. And ideally, so my starting point is minus 43. And so let's see whether the optimization works. However, when you play around with it, it's often quite frustrating, this running these optimization procedures. So often you run into numerical instabilities. In particular, I couldn't get to run the Mauna Lua dataset. I couldn't optimize the hyperparameters here. So I would have to fiddle around further, but I couldn't do it. Anyway, so let's see what we get. And let's look at the plot. So this is the suggestion that we get from the data. Okay, so it looks like this thing down here is not considered to be something that goes up and down, because if I would fit this, then the fit here, I would pay more, right? So in principle, I want to decrease the variance. I want to decrease the tube around my data. And so if I would increase it around here, I also would have to increase it at the other location, since I'm looking at a stationary kernel. And this is now a trade-off. So which is better, fitting the data here more nicely or having here a really tight fit over there, okay? And in this case now, what's happening is that the overall variance was increased, okay, probably to fit these data points up there. The overall smoothness here, so the length scale on the x-axis was also increased, and the variance on the y-axis stayed approximately the same, okay? Good. So far, so good. We still have a couple of minutes. So maybe something else which is kind of funny. So let's add something to the data. Okay, so let's shift the data up by 100 and let's see what's happening. Because if my assumption is that the mean function is zero, I can only fit it if I really increase the variability of my functions, right? So let's see what's happening. So for that, how can I do it? I think I can just say y being equal to y plus 100. Okay, I guess it works. Excuse me. So let's run the optimization. And for this simple example, it's super fast. And here you see, okay, and it increased the output variance by quite a bit. Yeah, it also increased here the length scale on that one, and it kept the noise variance. So let's see how it looks like. Okay, so that is the plot. And it's also not looking too bad, but in this case, kind of, it says, okay, I'm really up here now, very high, and I can only explain that by a much smoother function, which is just much smoother, okay? So that's like maybe already now an overfit. So you see, like, the overall level really plays an important role, whether you get a smooth function or not. So what happens if we do something more sensible? Let's say we remove the mean, okay? So let's say we say y minus, let's remove it, okay? So mean function was zero, and we only wanted to learn something about the shift from that one. So let's see what's happening now. So what do we get? Okay, we are back to variance of 10 over here, okay? The length scale is still large, the noise is still large. Let's have a plot. We get this one, maybe, which is slightly nicer than the one where we kind of omitted the mean function. So what I want to show you here is the mean function is also relevant, right? So the mean function cannot just be omitted and said, the mean function is zero, I don't care. Because it's really influencing also the variances that you get around your data, okay? Because if you need to put one parameter very large, so if you change the output variance, it will increase the output variance everywhere, right? If you want to reach these very large numbers. Okay, so I hope you got something out of this modeling stuff here. What we will do next time is, next time we will look at GP classification, okay, which is the last topic for Gaussian processes. So in that one, we will see how one can use Gaussian process regression for Gaussian process classification. In particular, you will also see into what problems we will run. So there are some things about GP regression which are so nice, everything is Gaussian. Only when you go to the hyperparameters, things get ugly. But when you do GP classification, things get ugly much earlier, okay? And for those situations, I will next time then tell you how to do a Laplace approximation to a GP and then to use a Laplace approximation for the GP classification. Okay, thanks a lot for the for your attention. I see there's a message from one of you. So the training set CSV, yes, I upload all the files that are mentioned in the notebook. Thanks for letting me know. Yeah, okay, great. Okay, so thanks for your attention and I see you on Wednesday. Bye-bye.